honorary chair, I assume. Okay. So, without further ado, I would like to invite the Prime Minister to open the cake. Thank you.
For us to implement today's motion in order to solve it, right? Two yardsticks to gauge which team wins today's debate. First of all, which team better ensures that that the individuals are comfortable and of good mental health and therefore better at learning? And second of all, which team better guarantees education for all, right? Before I go into my main substantive today, first, some basic definitions. One, we define mental disorder as a psychological illness, like a mental health illness, right? Second of all, we define mandatory as when you're diagnosed, regardless of whether or not you consent to it, you will be homeschooled. Three-point model to put this plan into action. First of all, we think that we're going to use government money to fund teachers if parents don't want to teach themselves or if they need the help in order to teach the student. We think that the consent must be given by the parent only if the student cannot consent to it as to like which of the two they would prefer. Second of all, we think that students must have at least bi-weekly therapy to check that they're doing fine, that they're making improvements. And third of all, we think that the student should be allowed to return to school if it is confirmed that they have definitely recovered from their mental illness, right? Okay, now jumping straight into my substantive points, which are as follows. First of all, why our house gives the best for the student's mental health. Second of all, how this connects to the capacity for learning. And third of all, why exactly this is important. I'll be talking about government obligation at that point, right? Okay, now diving straight into my first point, which is to say, which house better guarantee the student's health? We think that in the status quo, schools are characterized by three main things, right? They're inflexible. Two, they have requirements, for example, tests and coursework. And three, there are peers and lots of other students, right? Okay. We think that this is bad on three main levels. One, we think that the inflexibility means that it is difficult to make accommodations for students. Second of all, we think that because it's so demanding, students are often going to stress. And third of all, because of peers, we think that students often have bad self-esteem because they're bullied or because they have problems with being around large numbers of people, right? So how exactly does our motion solve one of these problems? One, we think that students are often more comfortable with being around their parents or around a single individual whom they know and whom they can trust in, right? We think that this is beneficial towards their sense of security and towards their sense of health and towards relieving their stress and making sure that they feel comfortable, right? And second of all, we think that when it's homeschooling, because there are fewer students, it is possible for us to adjust the pace to suit the individual, which means that it's better. Which means that we do not place them under too much stress. We do not place them under too much pressure. We could worsen their mental illness, right? And third of all, we think that it's possible for us to accommodate for the specific needs of the individual student to ensure that their mental illnesses are not exacerbated. For example, if they need to be alone for a certain period of time between interacting with people, we think that this is only able to be achieved often under homeschooling when there's no need to consider other individuals. Right. So we think that this is conducive towards two main things. One, we think that in the immediate short term, this makes them feel more secure. And two, we think that it also, in the long term, helps them recover more efficiently. And we think that this is one of the most important things in today's debate. Right? Okay, so now let me give you the comparative. Why exactly is it so awful under this of the house? Because we think that peer pressure means that there's peer pressure, and flexibility, I've told you about this. And in the short term, we think that this means that their mental health worsens, right? We think their self-esteem drops. We think that their problems become more and more comfortable. And we think that this can result in really serious things like suicide, right? We think that youth suicide rates are going ever higher, and it's impossible for us to neglect something as serious as this when an individual's right to life is being put into risk, right? Okay, but in the long term, we think that, first of all, it means that their mental health issue is more and more difficult to solve as time passes on, and we think that we run the risk that it becomes permanent, right? And second of all, it's important for us to cure it in the short term, right? And the second reason why it's so harmful in the long term leads me on to my second point of substantive, which is to say it means that it inhibits the individual's capacity to learn. Why exactly is this? Because in the status quo, we see the individual is less comfortable, we see that they fear school, and they have bad connotations with being educated and receiving knowledge. And we think that it also that means that they're, comes up, that they're more likely to misbehave or to have behavior which does not lead them to study better, right? And we think that this altogether inhibits their ability to learn and their ability to study and absorb the knowledge which a school is meant to give you. What you disagree, Mom?
Can you give us some concrete examples as to what kind of mental illnesses and psychological illnesses that you're referring to?
Okay, I think I've already told you about this, right? For example, bullying, which can cause depression. We think things like ADHD, which is exacerbated by stress. We think that in mental illnesses, which are exacerbated by being in school, all fall under this category, right? Sorry about what happened. Okay, but so going back to my substantive, we think that in the long term, this means that one, they're less able to fend for themselves in society because they were unable to learn as well as they could have within school because of the fact that we weren't able to accommodate for their illness, right? So we think that this means that they struggle to survive in society. We think that this is inherently bad because you're less able to contribute and because you're less able to ensure that you're able to live at a good standard of living. And second, what we also think that has a wider societal impact, which is to say that people have a worse perception of people with mental disorders, right? Because they think that you're less educated, they think that they're less educated, right? That they're less able to fend for themselves. And we think that by implementing this version, we can help resolve this kind of perception and help resolve the stigma, right? But other than that, no thank you, Mom. We think that there's also another reason why it's so important is because the government has an obligation to put this motion into action, right? Why? Two main reasons. One, because the government has a moral responsibility and a prerogative to protect individuals from harm. We think that when an individual is mentally ill and when it has been exacerbated and made worse by the situation that they are in, we think that this interferes with their right to a dignified life and a right to safety and security, right? We think that because the government isn't doing enough to ensure that this does not happen in the same school, we think that this is actually a failing on the government's part to protect an individual from an illness, which is just as legitimate as any physical illness, right? We think that the government do provide extenuating circumstances for individuals who are physically ill, and we think that this should also be true for those who are mentally ill, right? And second of all, because we think that individuals have a right to education, right? We've already proven to you why it has interfered with under the status quo, and we think that it is a necessary measure for us to implement this motion in order to protect it. Especially because children are, one, so vulnerable, two, dependent, and three, are so easily molded at a young age, right? We think that they're especially vulnerable, important stakeholder, and we have to implement this motion. We also think that we send a positive message to society by implementing this motion. One, because it sends that message that it's a serious issue and an illness that must be taken seriously. And second, well, because it sends the idea that education is for all. It resolves stigma, and this is really important because it helps prevent mental illness in the long term. Thank you. This is when this house must have stand.
I thank the Prime Minister for her speech. Now I would like to invite leader of opposition to open the case.
We think that the solution to a problem is not hiding a problem. And even if we think that, Thai government told us that it is a temporary thing and students are allowed to return to the school when they finish the problem. We still think that to solve the problem once and for all and solve it in a root cause level is by having internal change in the students themselves. Today in my speech, I will prove to you why, why this problem in itself is, why this motion in itself is not protecting the children rather than encouraging the children to escape the problem. Second of all, I will propose a counter model and elaborate to you how its mechanism. So first of all, we think that this motion is morally unjust because we think that A, it is simply escaping from the problem, right? So what we are saying is that homeschooling is simply putting the, because students have their problem happen at school, so what homeschooling aim at is to get them out of school and therefore they are out of their problem. But what government didn't notice is that the fact that escaping from where a problem happened doesn't necessarily mean that solving the problem, right? So even this is wrong, right? We think that this is still non-achieved because it is ineffective in solving the problem, right? So what we mean by that, we need some special characterization of school-related problem, right? So we define school-related problem into two layers. Either it is because of the students have problem themselves or have misunderstanding themselves, or second, because of other people surrounding, right? So the A example will be like, for example, students not getting asked by teachers to answer a question, and therefore they think a teacher don't like us. Or, and the example of B will be that bully, right? Very serious. So remember these two characteristics of school related problem. And we would like to remind you that these two problems will not be solved by homeschooling, because we think homeschooling is simply escaping a problem. And what essentially is the most important thing is that you are not letting the student do some internal change internally, right? So what I'm saying is that students need to change based on their mind, and students need to change their behavior, their role, their characters, such, right? And this is not solving a problem in its essence, right? So second of all, I want to talk about the harms of this motion. So what harms will you actually bring and you put students out of school, right? So when students are out of school, students would lack schooling by a period of time. And what this is problematic is that A, because the fact that school does not only teach knowledge, it also teaches people how to socialize and interact with each other, right? So when you are not in the school, you are simply lacking a very crucial part, that is experiencing a minimized society when you are young and you are protected by different maybe teachers or guardians, right? And we think this is really, really important, because without this, students will lack advantages when they graduate, and this will make them into losers in life, like us. So moving on, something that is also very serious is that we scare that homeschooling in itself will create a mindset that makes students rely on homeschooling itself. What I'm saying is that students, when they are perhaps they are bullied at school and now you are homeschooling them, and they will think that I can be homeschooled for my entire life, then I won't be bullied for my entire life. But that is not the correct mindset, ladies and gentlemen. What correct mindset is I will be elaborated in my counter model as below. So our counter model is that every time a school spotted some school related issue, we will report to the government, and government will send a person related to this and will come to school and help that kid inside of the school, right? So we are saying that because A, by doing so, we will be able to let the students still be inside the environment where their problem is, so that they can tackle their problem side by side with courage, except instead of escaping from the problem. And second. Remember the problem A1 and A2 I said before, the how school-related problem is usually how one, students have misunderstanding or problem in themselves, and B, is other people extension. So I will talk about how this motion actually solves these two problems, A and B. So A first, it is students' internal problem or misunderstanding, right? So the guy we send there, he will help students to realize the problem. If it is a misunderstanding, it will tell the students that it is actually not your fault. So this is also something worth mentioning, right? Because students always think that everything is their own fault, right? Because the thing is that students despite the fact that they are already young, they already develop independence in believing their own, right? So when they believe in their own, they think that they can solve the problem by themselves. So what we are saying is that when there is misunderstanding, or when there is problem with their students themselves, they don't realize that it is their own problem, and they think that it is someone else's problem, and that is why they won't improve themselves internally, and that is why the problem will never be changed, right? So when our guy tell the student that it is your own problem or your own misunderstanding, we think that this is what will ultimately cause the student to change internally and really be able to have a well and all-rounded life, right?
Sure.
So on the second part, on how is other people affected, for example, bullying, right? Again, bullying, it is a very usual conception for students to believe that they are bullied because of their own problem rather than other people's problem, right? You won't think that the bullier and the guy being bullied will think that he is bullied by the bullier because he has something wrong, right? But actually, that is not the case, right? Sometimes there might be just some unlucky or seemingly unjust, right? For example, difference in religions or different in body appearance. For example, he is handsomer than me, so I will get bullied. Something like that, right? So what we are saying here is that we need to tell the students that in terms of other people's affection, it is actually not their mistake, and it is actually not their fault, and actually, and after we've done this part, we want to boost the student's self-esteem, because we want the students to know that it is actually not their fault in the school-related cost problem, right? And by doing this, we will actually also achieve what side government want to see, right? Improve self-esteem and improve and lower stress. And afterwards, after we let the students know what it is not their own problem, we will organize meeting or organize negotiation between the students and the bullies themselves. And really, we need to talk the problem out, because we believe that talking and understanding each other is the way of every solution, right? So with that said, let's take a look at a comparative between government and opposition, right? So on government, we have a side very idealistic thinking that escaping from the problem is the solution to the problem. And they also say that, or they can temporarily let them homeschooling, and they will send them back to school. Now, I've said before, this temporary thing is not really legit because, first of all, students will develop a mindset to escape from that problem. And second of all, even when they get back to school, the things they talk in home won't solve their mental problem because it cannot solve the problem internally caused by a student. Thank you.
I thank the leader of opposition for his speech.
Sorry, say it again.
Now I would like to invite Deputy Prime Minister here. Here.
Gentlemen, we understand that the two main stakeholders in today's debate, right, are the different types of students that exist when they are grown. First being the slower students who we outlined have mental disorders and who are mentally handicapped, and the second one being regular students who require challenge and so forth for them to actually develop, as opposed to the previously mentioned students who require a sensitive environment. Now, on opening government today, we've outlined how these two things cannot healthily exist, and both parties end up suffering. And for those reasons, we believe it's the obligation not only of the government, but of the schools themselves to make sure people with mental disorders are removed and schooled at home. But before I move on to some more substantive on opening government, a few rebuttals to deal with, right? First of all, opening opposition has told us that instead of hiding these students away, we should force them to be in school so that they can make internal changes, right? Now we understand that it is important that they make internal changes, but these changes cannot possibly come to life when they are placed in an environment that is uncomfortable for them, when they are constantly being rushed, and when other students are very likely to make fun of them because of their own handicaps, right? We say that that's not possible. We also want internal change, but it happens better in our model. Second thing to deal with when it comes to rebuttals, opening opposition told us that to solve the root cause of the problem of mental disorders, we need them to have social skills and therefore they need to be in school. Two responses to this. First of all, we agree that they need to have social skills, but we say that they won't develop those social skills by throwing them in the deep end without actually giving them any legitimate help. We say that when we put them with other students who are not mentally handicapped, it's likely that bullying will take place, and as a result, they will further develop depression or low self-esteem because they are constantly being mocked for not being good enough just at birth because of their mental handicaps, right? Second response to the social skills point, we say that academic skills are also equally as important, and these can only truly be fostered to cater to that individual student's special needs when they are schooled at home, right? Third response, they brought up a counter model in opening opposition, which is that they would have therapy and school at the same time, right? Because they want to fix their self-esteem inside and out. We say that it's counterintuitive to have therapy going on while things in school are constantly getting worse. We say that therapy will not be able to solve anything if you're going to school hours every day and everyone is constantly mocking you and you don't understand a thing, right? We say that their therapy proposal is possible on our side of the model. In fact, it's better with our side of the model because we don't have anything holding it back, which is students in school who are not mentally handicapped, constantly mocking them, constantly showing that they're better just by contributing in class, even if they don't want to bully them, right? Now, with that established, onto the further substantive I'd like to bring up today, right? Now, because there are varying skill levels in class, because they're so drastic when we have individuals with mental disorders, we see one of these three things inevitably happening if our policy is not implemented, right? First thing that might happen, the school will make it too fast for the student with the mental disorder, and as a result, they'll suffer. My Prime Minister has already covered both the academic and the social detriments that happens if we make it too fast for the student. Before I move on then, yes.
Is there any intermediate between being in class and being completely separate from school and being homeschooled?
Yes, thank you. We say that there is a difference, right? Because what you're suggesting is that when they're taking out of class, they're immediately lacking social skills. We say that their social skills are suffering even more when we put them in a class where they don't belong, right? We say that the absence of something, which is in your best case scenario, our worst case scenario, we say that the absence of something is still better than having something that's so damaged you can't function as an individual, right? But back to our own substantive, right? Okay, first thing that's going to happen when the skill levels are so varied, it's too fast for the mentally handicapped student and they will suffer as a result. Prime Minister has already covered why this is bad. Second thing that might happen, which I'll be covering, is we make it too slow for the capable students and as a result, they will suffer. And the third thing that would happen is we end up with an uncomfortable compromise where neither of the parties receive a satisfactory education because the teachers are trying to cater to all these very different parties, right? Now, the first thing, the first scenario, it's unfair to the non-mentally handicapped students, right, when we make it too slow and the mentally handicapped students can deal with the pace, right? We say it's if we make it comfortable for the other party, it will inevitably become uncomfortable for the party that is not mentally handicapped. We say that it's immoral to deny these individuals the education that school, that government promised them because we're taking away challenges because those challenges cannot apply to people who are mentally handicapped, right? We also bring up the two detrimental practical impacts of making it too slow for non-mentally handicapped people, right? The first one being, they're not realizing their full potential in school, right? This means that they're not receiving a proper education and later on could potentially inhibit their ability to contribute to society. The second detrimental impact, we say, they become resentful when they are aware of the fact that they are not receiving a proper education. This would contribute to the culture of bullying that our Prime Minister outlined, further hurting the mentally handicapped people's esteem and further contributing to these harms that she already outlined, right? Now, onto the second scenario. We end up with an uncomfortable compromise that is neither too fast nor too slow for both parties involved, right? This is probably what's going to happen as the teacher tries to cater to all parties involved in school. But we say when this happens, neither of them are receiving a satisfactory education, and it's possibly the worst case scenario, a stalemate where no one is actually being properly educated, right? So we say that none of these scenarios end up with students getting a satisfactory schooling, right? We say on top of the government's responsibility, which our Prime Minister brought up, it's the responsibility of the schools to provide that satisfactory education. Now, our Prime Minister told you the mechanism of exactly how removing mentally handicapped students from the stressful school scene would A, make these students more comfortable and give them more effective learning, and B, allow other students to excel because there's no one holding them back in the schooling scene, right? With these two things established, because schools can change this unsatisfactory education with our policy, they have an obligation and a responsibility to implement the policy that is conducive to that change, which is removing mentally handicapped people from the scene and allowing them to be schooled at home. And for these reasons, we're very, very proud to propose. Thank you.
I would like to thank the Deputy Prime Minister for her speech. Now, I would like to invite Deputy Leader of Opposition to continue their case. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, today, the leader of opposition has already told us some exclusive harm for homeschooling the students, which are some wrong mindsets and ineffectiveness to solve the problem, right? But the opening government didn't rebut at this point at all about the wrong mindset of students. But before anything, some rebuttals, right? So, first of all, they say that all students with mental disorders should be trapped at home, right? But we say that, for example, in society, all those people with mental disorders are they all imprisoned at homes and not allowed to socialize or work? They are not, right? So we don't see that how this case should appear in schooling, right? So number two, they say that our current model, the therapy, isn't working. But we say that it's going to work because look at the general cases in society. The people with mental disorders are actually going to find therapy or treatments, right? But meanwhile, they continue to life and they don't work and they don't socialize. And we say that they can recover after all. This is the general case, right? So therefore, we say that the therapy handling at school can actually solve the problem, right? So, but the exclusive harm, talking about the exclusive harm of this motion is that it is creating a wrong mindset for students that they can escape from the problem at school if they stay at home forever. Like us, right? If I don't join a debate tournament, I won't end up getting humiliated here, right? So we see that the students in the future will end up in the same mindset and they will become non-productive anyways. Therefore, we see that in the long term, in the long term perspective, it is also harmful, right? So today, ladies and gentlemen, as this side opposition, we are also wanting to help the students, but with us, the main actors are also the students, right? But we say that we are not doing such harmful policy in order to help these children, right? So, first of all, sir, I want to say that this policy is not practical at all. Like, Thai government has told us about, oh, we're going to hire tutors in order to teach the students at their home, but we say that it's not practical at all. Like, if a government sent many teachers to the students, like, for example, like me, I'm going to study 9 subjects, Chinese, English, mathematics, liberal studies, and 5 electives, like, and then the government are going to pay the teachers, 9 teachers, 9 teachers to come to teach me, right? So, like, let's talk about a not extreme case, right? Maybe 3 or 4, but we don't see that it's practical because we cannot send such so many teachers to every single student with mental disorder, right? So even if the government side come and tell us, oh, they're going to watch the videos at YouTube and they're going to learn themselves, we say that it's still harmful as the socializing problem is not solved at all. So ladies and gentlemen, when you talk about the main actors as students in this case, it is not beneficial for those students at all. Because first of all, when we look at the status school, they suffer from the school problems, they suffer from the school life, and the status school is, oh, they now study at school, and they suffer from certain condition like high stress or bullying, getting bullied by their classmates or schoolmates, and when they can't withstand such pressure or condition, they end up with mental disorders, right? But the, in government's case, the root problem isn't solved. There are still bullies in the school. There are still pressure in the school. And we see that by this homeschooling, the government is actually ignoring the whole problem because in the future, there are still vulnerable students, like the not yet getting mental disorder students getting such a problem in the future, right? So, we also say that for those students who are studying at home, we see that once they are killed, they are actually sent back to the school, right? So they are actually facing the same problem again. So anyway, there are 2 cases here.
Sir.
When those students go back to school and they face the same problem, they either overcome the problem or not, right? So number one, when we talk about they are actually overcoming the problem, we don't see why this should put into homeschooling anyway. In the first place, as my partner said, we're going to tackle the problem and help them because if they can actually overcome the problem, why should we put them in the home? Why should we imprison them in the home in the first place without a choice, right? So another case is that if they don't overcome the problem, right, then it is proving that the policy is ineffective anyway because after homeschooling, the problem isn't solved anyway. It's become, and when the students go to school and face the same problem, they become sick again, and they are getting into their home again, right? So it's actually a cycle where the problem is not solved at all. So, even if they study at home, we don't see how it's solved the problem effectively, right? So, because it is not only the bullying and not only the socializing problem, we see that academic pressure is also a main factor. But we see that the majority of the people actually can get through this process, right? Like everyone in this room are actually getting through the process of schooling in more than 10 years, right? So there's no use to carry out the policy, right? So moreover, as mentioned before, the school is a major society where the students practice how to survive in the society as they grow. And when the students fail to get through these courses, we are actually simply escaping from this problem by getting them in a safe space and preventing them from actually learn how to solve this problem, learn how to deal with it. Right? So, lastly, the students lose the chance to stay in a community where they get through the courses of schooling with other people, and we don't see any benefits brought by trapping them inside the home because I don't think that it is healthy for the students to like stay alone in the home anyway. It's not healthy for their mind. So after some short-term things, let's talk about the long-term things, right? So we are actually, by policy, we spread a message that in the society that we allow students to escape or ignore the problem faced. And it's creating long-term harm to society. Because eventually, when the next generation is dominating the society, they have a mindset of, oh, once I face problem, once I feel unhappy, once I feel unsatisfied, I can simply quit socializing or working. I can simply stay at my home and get a subsidy from the government to survive, right? So we see that it's eventually a harm to society, because if they have such mindsets, we see an increase of people who have who are actually escaping from the problem in the work or whatever. They are actually non-productive to the whole society. Therefore, very proud to oppose.
I thank the Deputy Leader of Opposition for his speech. Now I would like to invite a member of government to open the law house debate.
Side opposition, like thinking this as a movie, like the accountant, where when you give an autistic Ben Affleck, like how a few of the society, they automatically know how to deal with it. Unfortunately, that's not the case, right? It turns out, first of all, let's rebut your point, right? That we need to give these traumatized people like a way to deal with life. There are two kinds of people who are traumatized, right? Either you're very traumatized, i.e. you're so sick of school that you simply cannot go back, or you're like mildly traumatized, right? You're very stressed out, you have anxiety, with depression, etc., right? We say that if we follow their approach, what will happen is that people who are even mildly traumatized is going to be, this issue will be exacerbated, and they're going to be the people who are very traumatized, right? And we do not support for that, right? Because it will mean that more people are willing to deal and unwilling and unable to deal with the issues in life, first of all. And secondly, we say that it's unfair to push people back to the hell they want to escape. And okay, if you're the very traumatized people, we say as a government that we're happy to take care for you, we're happy to like look after you, because we recognize that that you have problems or obstacles, and we're willing to help you overcome them. So, as the extension speaker, what is my main extension, right? We tell that today's debate is not just about individual students or the students, small group who have a mental disorder caused by the school, right? We tell it's an issue that's burdened by the school community, and we tell you why it's on our side that it's uniquely more beneficial for the school community if we remove these students and we put them so they can be taught at home. First point, right, principal point. Why do we think that a school as a community should not be burdened with this issue, right? Because we tell that it's unfair to like call students to deal with this problem, right? I.e. to adapt to this problem, to accept these people. We recognize that yes, ultimately they have to accept these people, they have to learn how to interact with people who have like mental illness, right? But we say we should not let them interact with these people like at a very young age, right? Why? Because we say the kids are less mature, right? They're less capable, there's less mental capability to like deal with this, right? The same reason we don't give them the right to vote, the same reason we don't let them to drink, is because we recognize that they're still kids, right? And so at the same time, we see we should not hold them to the same standard as we hold to adults, right? We should not expect them to be able to deal with people who are mentally mentally traumatized, and therefore we proudly stand for the fact that we should not place these people in the school community and let them to deal with them. Right. Okay, second point, right? Mm-hmm. We also tell you that, yeah, we agree with the premise brought by the opposition. Let me finish this. That, yeah, sure, the school is a place that will prepare you for the world, right? But we disagree with the characterization that school is basically a simulation of reality. Ladies and gentlemen, the educational bureau is not called the simulation bureau, right? It's called the education bureau for one reason, right? And this is something we stand for one reason.
Would you prevent racism by only allowing students of one race in the school so they won't be mean?
No, we teach people that racism is wrong, right? We do not automatically just put a few like certain like a racial minority into the class and expect them to like play together and play peacefully. That's not the right way to go. That's something we do not agree. Fine, okay.
School also teach that bullying is wrong, but bullying still exists in school. Can you explain?
Yeah, that's why we have like people who who sometimes takes away the kids who are bullied, and then also we also teach other people that bullying is not right, etc., etc. We do not just put them there so they will go through hell again, and they have to, like, in their own cage, learn how to interact with each other. That's not the right way to go. Right, okay, allow me to continue. So what is the impact of, like, allowing, like, people to, like, go to school and then like, let these people, like, put them in a cage and then assume that they can interact with each other, right? First of all, we have to understand the fact that when you have a mental disorder, that you're, in many cases, you're especially difficult to deal with, right? And we say that when you're difficult to deal with, children, as I said before, they don't have the patience to deal with these people. They're not trained to deal with, like, people with mental disorder, i.e. because they're not, like, a therapist. You don't call kids a therapist, and therefore, they are unable to deal with these kids, right? And therefore, it's easy for them to take the easy path, right? They're likely to bully these kids, to not, like, be inclusive, and, like, not join them at recess, even kick them for every time they cry out when the teacher, like, does ignore them in class, etc., etc. And we say, it is things like this that would be detrimental when they grow up. Why? Because, as they said before in their speech, that when the school teaches you how to become a person and become an adult, they teach you how to deal with life in general. So when you allow kids to do this in school, this kind of message, this kind of perception will move on, and when they grow up, they will still have the same kind of perception, right? They still have the same kind of idea that it's okay to do the same to their kids, right? Two scenarios here. Either one, you're told off by the teacher that you should not be bad to this kid, right? If you're told off, then, okay, sure, you will not be bad, right? But you still look down on these people who have, like, mental disorder, and you will find it difficult to interact with them when you grow up. Two, if you're not told off by the teacher, and you're expected to, like, deal with that person as, like, a normal individual who have no mental disorder, you end up developing, like, a discriminatory mindset against these people, and it will still be detrimental, because when you grow up, you still look down on these people and think of them as, like, nuisance or trouble, right? And this is why we agree to a situation where, okay, sure, like, we believe that in a situation where the school should temporarily remove these encounter individuals when it's becoming too hard for them to burden this, and in the process, teaching these children, students in school, how to deal with these kind of issues before putting them back and slowly letting the person integrate into society, right? This is why we understand the opposition case, where they just directly throw them into the pit and expect everything to go fine. And this is also why it's mutually exclusive. This is why we do not agree to their premise, right? But finally, we say it's also stressful on teachers, like, to expect them to deal with the kids, right? We recognize that they already have a high-stress job. We also recognize that they're not doctors or therapists, right? So we cannot expect them to deal with this again and then to increase their workload and their stress, right? And this is why we say it's unfair on the school committee as a whole. So on the whole, what I've told you today, right? First of all, I've told you that it's unfair on the teacher, and second of all, it's unfair on the school community, because we tell you that the second you put them into your pit, right, and you simply, by just that, although it's okay to, like, teach people not to bully, as brought up by the example by the POI in his, in Keith's POI, we tell you that when you put something like a target there, they'll be easier to act by the instincts, which is namely the easier to bully that kid, and they'll slowly learn it, right? On the other hand, if you teach the kid first, so he or she has an instruction manual in mind as to how to deal with the kid, you say it's easier to include these kind of kids, it's easier to like let all the benefits such as by all happen. Thank you.
I thank the member of government for his speech. Now I would like to invite the member of opposition to open the case for COG.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, today, as a member of opposition, I will explain to you what schools actually do and what do they do with mentally students with mental disorders in the South Squad. I'll explain to you what mental disorders really are, how do they work, and I'll bring unique characterizations that no other team has brought so far today, that no other team has sought to actually understand how this current system works, right? And if I have time, I'll talk about the social message this sends to children when you separate them from one another, right? But before I move on to my substantive, I'd like to give some rebuttal, right? So firstly, we think this idea that, you know, that government has given us that, oh, we don't want to throw these children into a pit, right? Don't want to throw them to the end of the pit. We think they misunderstand school, right? They present to us this false dichotomy of A, right? You're a normal student, you have no special privileges or access or anything like that. Or B, you're a homeschooled student. And we don't think this is true, right? We think to get to, like, what do schools do, right? We think there are different things that can happen concurrently when you're at school, right? We think there's counseling, right? There's adaption to fit the unique needs of the students, right? This includes maybe lessening course loads or maybe more help for courses outside of class. Right? We don't think there's this massive dichotomy of we either go to school or we either don't go to school. And we think this is something that was not understood at all by side government. Yes?
We think that mental therapy would be much more effective if we remove the students from the stimulus for the students.
Okay, so we don't understand how mentally disordered students necessarily are so worried, like, damaged by stimulus in this situation, right? And so, secondly, we look at this idea given to us about, you know, mentally disordered students, right? So we look at the examples given to us by the Prime Minister, right? ADHD and depression, right? And so the upward opening government has come up and said, you know, we're going to keep them homeschooled until, you know, they get cured of their disease and then they can come back, right? And we don't think this makes any sense, right? We look at diseases like ADHD, like depression, that the open government brought up, right? We don't think these are just diseases that simply can be cured. These diseases are managed and accepted, right? These diseases, you know, you have some medication, you have some coping mechanisms, and you learn to live with these diseases, right? There's no situation and suddenly, you know what? Suddenly, I'm not hyperactive, right? This is simply not how mental diseases work, right? And we see that these mental disorders are something these individuals are going to have to live with the rest of their life, but they have to become adults and cope with these, right? Have jobs, they'll hypothetically have a family, right? And so we think that a yardstick that side government has completely neglected is how will these students become adults, right? Which side is better for adapting these students into adult life, right? Helping them actually in the long term. Yes?
Why is it acceptable for us to torment students in the short term when it's perfectly possible to give them the social skills they need outside of school? For example, you don't think that it's impossible for them to socialize in school?
We don't think, firstly, that there's necessarily an element of torment just because you're in school. They have failed to show to us, you know, how these people are so tormented. Right? Instead, they've come up with, you know, well, there's a lot of bullying, and they have academic issues. So I didn't explain to you how academic issues can be dealt with. But we don't think bullying is such a big problem that it deserves homeschooling. Right? We see lots of children are bullied, and we think that this can be adapted, and bullying can be dealt with in schools, right? And so, no, thank you. So, let me discuss the harms of homeschooling, right? So what side government has completely neglected in terms of trauma, it's like, what message do you send children when you separate them, right? Side government, a member of government has come and told, you know, we actually separate kids on race because we don't want them to be racist, and we think this is fundamentally untrue, and this is a major flaw in their case, right? They think that their understanding is that children are inherently cruel and they're somehow not open-minded, and so when they're, you know, exposed to people who are different, right, they'll think, oh, you're different, I don't want to be friends with them. And we don't think this is necessarily true. But we think instead is when you tell children, right, instead what everyone wants to do is tell children, these people are different, this person is not going to be in the class with you. You cannot be in the class with everybody else because you're weird, because you're different, right? You're special and you need special needs and you're just not fit to be with everyone else. Right? So we think children are impressionable, but on side government, right, what they're teaching children is that you're different and that you're not normal. And so what we think this will cause, no thank you, is not some greater understanding down the road when, like, somehow kids are, like, much nicer. But we think this teaches children that these people are not normal, right? And we think this is particularly because you're categorically homeschooling all people with mental disorder. And we also see, no thank you, that you don't teach children how to live with their mental disorders, right? When you give a kid with ADHD, right, you keep them in a homeschooled environment, right? You don't actually teach them how to interact with lots of other people. How do you interact with immature people, right? We don't think this actually teaches them the skills they need to be when they're an adult, right? When they need to earn money, have a job, opening.
Even if special students could socially recover even with constant bullying, please outline how it would be possible to provide everyone a satisfactory education when they can never get academically better with their conditions.
Okay, thank you. So firstly, we think that they haven't proven to us that there's always constant bullying, and we don't think this is necessarily true, or we don't think this is true in most cases, right? And secondly, right, I've already explained to you that schools, it's not like there's one course and you have to take all the classes, right? We think that in these cases, you can make special exemptions, you can have you can have, you know, less classes, you can have help outside school. And yes, I heard you say, you know, that makes them special, right? But we think, sure, that makes, you know, you are separating them, but you're minimizing the separation. You're minimizing, you know, how, you know, different they are, because you're still interacting with, because you're, no, thank you, you're still interacting with different people. And thirdly, we see this also fails the government's obligation to take care of children, right? We think that it, you know, forces these children back onto parents who need to go out and go work at jobs. And so we see that, you know, by forcing these children, this also disproportionately hurts parents, and especially mothers, who will be left with caretaking, as they will be forced to take care of their children and not have the lives of their own. So, ladies and gentlemen, what have I told you today? I've explained to you that there's not just, you know, two options when it comes to mentally disordered students. I've explained to you that there are different levels within schools, that there are different levels of assistance you can provide based on what is necessary. Secondly, I've explained to you that there's no simple cure that you can give mentally disordered students after, you know, send them homeschooled for 3 months, 6 months. I explained to you that it's an ongoing process that needs to be dealt, learn how these people need to learn how to deal with. And thirdly, I explained to you how there's a damaging social message when you separate children from their peers, saying, you're so different, you're so weird, you're not even allowed to be in the same, you know, building at them that everybody else is doing. And so, ladies and gentlemen, this motion must fall.
I thank the member of opposition for his speech. Now I would like to invite Reverend Webb to conclude the debate for Reverend Webb.
Gentlemen, before I've gone my clashes, some rebuttals towards the opposition bench, right? Now, we see a grander so-called proposal by opposition bench that they say that it could be better if there's an option of counseling them in schools. However, as I've raised in my previous POI, right, we agree that our common goal today is to make therapies, counseling, to make these students better. But as I pointed out, we don't understand why such therapy would be more efficient, would be more effective if these mentally ill students are still being placed within their stimulus, when these students are still continue being stimulated. We don't see how this therapy is going to be as effective as if we remove them from their stimulus for them to calm down. They also try to sample the so-called harm of this policy of that attacks students as being different. Right? We don't agree with this because if you don't face the problem, you can't solve the problem. What is the use of pretending that the student does not have mental illness? It's not a mental illness, it's like any other physical illness where it's invisible, where they can't see. Mental illness is mental illness and we believe it's easily visible. If the students are being traumatic in school, certainly there will be symptoms. For example, they aren't going back to school, or actually they have some abnormal behavior in school, which are the only symptoms that characterize them to have these sort of mental disorders stimulated from school environment. So we don't see how, even without this policy, that these people won't be tagged as having mental illness, as tagged as different as other people. And the case is, they are indeed different from other people because of these mental illnesses in terms of the mental state they have towards school. So we don't understand why it's necessary harm that these people are tagged out. And also finally, a brief rebuttal towards the opening. Right? They're saying that this policy is a problem because it can't solve the root cause of such mental illnesses. Now, we don't believe that this policy is actually here to solve the root cause of mental illness, but actually to help the students who already encountered these mental illnesses. So it does not understand how opening points stand. Now, moving on to my clashes. Now, the first clash of today's debate is basically the nature of homeschooling, right? Opposition today is trying to characterize homeschooling as basically a chance for students to escape from school forever, for students to no longer care about society, no longer care about school simply because they hate it. But our side does not think so. Our side believes that even if homeschooling as the model of science proposed, that even with homeschooling, it's precisely that during this homeschooling period, we provide mental therapy towards these students, that's precisely towards homeschooling that we're actually trying to cure the students' mental disorder. So therefore, we do think that the nature of homeschooling itself has the aim, which is the same as opposition, is trying to bring these students back to society, and we believe the homeschooling method is even more efficient than putting them counseling in school, as mentioned, as reasons I've mentioned before. The second clash today is opposition's try to question the practicality of homeschooling. My side does not understand. They seem to wrongly characterize homeschooling as a government sending 5 to 7 teachers for each subject to teach them individually. We do not believe homeschooling is based on that. We truly believe homeschooling as seen as effective in other countries simply for parents to teach them or through online courses or other teaching materials. And surely through government funding, we believe this is possible. And we also believe that as the model as stated by opening, it's certainly okay to have these sort of observers to make sure students are learning. So we don't question the practicality at all. Yes.
What is so special going on at school, so stimulating, that can disrupt therapy?
Well, that's why they got the mental disorder. The problem is not about what school is so... Well, the thing is, if the student does have mental disorder caused by school, then certainly school does have a special effect on them. I presume or else it's not school-stimulated mental disorder. And I think my third question today's debate of what is the best solution for all actors and what we want to achieve after all is for the students, for all actors to be more well off. Now, first actor today is, with, of course, the individual, right? And the individual, I think the government bench has already sufficiently proved today why the students, by removing them from the environment that stimulated these mental disorder, will be more better for them in terms of curing the disease. But more importantly, my members exclusively told you the more important actors in terms of the school community of how by removing these students away from the school environment, that it will be better for the school actor, right? We have shown to you of how by keeping these mental disorder students within the school community, they cause not only is this cause a disruption to its other students, but more importantly, it could cause a sort of wrong or negative implications towards the mental disorder, because we can easily expect that there is a probability that these students are going to clash with other students because of their disorder. So therefore, we believe that these negative implications, which is a major harm on society. We also talked about how the harms over teachers as the extra burden, as teachers are not supposed to help cure mental disorders, not to deal with mental disorders on a day-in, day-out basis consistently. So therefore, science has sufficiently proved the harm to the school, right? But however, the opportunity today is trying to characterize the best solution for all actors is simply for the students to remain in the school and just somehow wait for it to magically recover. And our site clearly has already taken down why this solution doesn't work, because of the fact that by students remaining in the stimulus that caused their mental illness, we believe that the students will hardly be recovered, and by them remaining in school, as I mentioned, that causes harms on all parties. So it's clearly the best solution today, right, for the students and for the school and for society to get better, is to remove these students from the school and put them on homeschooling until, and luckily, if they did not have any mental disorder. So what the government bench today has proven to you of why homeschooling is necessary. Oh, yes.
How long do you think it's going to cure a mental disorder like ADHD or like depression?
We believe that, certainly, the mental disorder would take time to cure. But it doesn't mean that we shouldn't try to cure this disease to the best of ability, which is to remove them from the school environment. So then we're concluding to this debate, right? So I've mentioned the government bench today has proven to you why homeschooling is a necessary good thing. And closing government today has exclusively told you why homeschooling is beneficial not only to the individual, but to a more important actor, the school and society as a whole, as this affects much more people, affects more people in the learning, affects much more on society as a whole. So then we're concluding the debate. Closing government has proven to you why this motion must and will stand, and why closing government takes the championship. Thank you.
I thank the government whip for his speech. Now I would like to welcome the opposition whip to conclude the whole debate here.
Mental illness. The second clash is whether school or homeschooling is more effective to helping these students with mentally ill mental disorders. And three, what makes a better adult? Today we first see the Prime Minister and the Deputy Prime Minister come out and tell blatantly claim that mental illnesses will lead to them being attacked and it will be very difficult for them to manage in school. But first, they didn't tell us about the different types of mental illnesses that there are, and they also didn't tell us that there are what different types of severities of mental illnesses that there's going to be. And then they just came out and they tell us that, oh, if we don't solve this issue now, mildly will become more permanent. But they didn't explain that point as well, right? Okay, I understand that depression might become more serious, but how is your ADHD going to be more serious if you don't treat it currently? And they just really gave no explanation towards that. And moreover, they come out and tell us that, oh, mental illnesses, and they really say that there's problem with these people, these students. And that's why the leader of the opposition came up today and said that this is a mutual problem. This is not only the problem of the students, and this is also the problem that everybody, including the school, including parents, including other students, should tackle together. And moreover, they didn't really, like, in the point of information of the upper house of the opposition, they came out and they came out and told and asked, right, are all bullying because of mental illnesses? And they didn't really respond to, is it always the case where one person, because they're different, they're necessarily lead to being discriminated? So they didn't really explain this point either. And that's why today my member of the opposition came out and tried to tell you that not all mental illnesses can be cured, right? And not everything can be recovered from. And also bad things doesn't necessarily go away. And my member of the opposition tried to come out and tell you that instead we should try to cope with this problem rather than cure with this problem. And we understand what we're trying to say is mental illnesses can be good and bad. And if we were to cope with this, the mental illnesses, which may be a disadvantage, can later maybe transform into an advantage to themselves.
Because you said mental illness cannot be cured, why let the school community suffer with them all the way?
Okay, thank you for your point of information. And that's because what we see is that currently in our schools, when a child has a mental illness and they sort of want to seek help, they don't know who to approach or like what kind of direct response they can get to receive treatment from their mental illness. And that's why in the counter model of the upper house of the opposition, they try to show you is that we're going to provide, if the symptoms are so visible, then because our current situation, we don't have direct response, and that's why we're going to give them direct response through the reporting of the cases. And this also leads to my second clash about whether homeschooling or normal school is going to be more effective, right? Today, the government and the Prime Minister has told us today that you need consent, and if the students cannot make their own decisions, that the parent can help them. But clearly, they characterize the students as very unknowing and unknowledgeable and don't know what to do. And this is what we believe. This is not the case. And moreover, they have talked about how inflexible that school is. But if you're going to impose this sort of bi-weekly therapy on top of it, it's not necessarily flexible as well. No, thank you. And later, they also, in their model, they come out and told us that, oh, we'll later reintegrate them back into the school, right? And they say that the school in itself is already a very uncomfortable environment. So what we also see is that unfamiliarity with the school will also lead to uncomfortableness. So how are they going to lead back reintegrate back to the school? And they say that, the school cannot provide them with a sense of belonging, right? And the home parents can give them trust and sense of belonging. But this can also happen, support can also happen within the school, right? And also, since they didn't give you so many examples, right? For example, my member of the opposition here has dyslexia and it affects his performance in school, right? And that's why the school gives him longer testing time, and that's why he's using iPad. And they clearly did not let him did not consider other ways that the school can actually deal with it. It's just that the school has not yet been developed and given the funding or opportunities to develop it. Yes.
Okay. As I said, an OG was accepted to disadvantage other students and allow stigma to perpetuate society just because the severity of these school-called mental disorders is not always the same?
What you said is there's stigma and it'll affect other students. Well, firstly, what I want to say is you're a member of the government has come on today and say, oh, we can educate people and reduce stigma. But this has not been heard consistently throughout the government and we don't know how we're going to reduce stigma. And also, what we want to ask is that, is it more important to be inclusive or is it more important to advance my own academic achievement, right? We, on our side, if you say that mentally disordered people so need this sense of belonging and they're so important and the government have a responsibility, then equally other students should also take up on that responsibility. And what we also see is that they have said that school is not assimilation, but actually what we see is that school is stressful, but society is even more stressful. And how is like homeschooling going to help them become a better adult in the society? And lastly, I also want to talk about how like they told us that only through learning, they didn't really mention how learning will lead to like them being better adults and maximize their potential. And what we see is that there's sacrifice and you need parts of like academic learning and you also need social learning. And they say that, society can also, in homeschooling, they can also have other ways to approach, improve their social skills. But then why don't you put it in their model and why not in the school, right? And that's why, as the government, we have shown you how it's harmful to send the wrong message. And it's also actually good to become resilient.